us just a second, please. Mrs. Riston has said that I was a loser.
I didn't say that.
And she wants y'all to pray for me.
I do want to thank God.
Bless you, Shelby.
Let's just be the first thing I do is thank Him for helping me be here today. I haven't been feeling good, but Thursday night or Friday night, I just couldn't take it anymore. I couldn't swallow. And I went in my bed. I told Chris, I said, I may have to go to the hospital. But I went in my bed and I said, Lord, please come down off your throne and touch my throat. And I fell asleep. And I woke up and my fever was gone and
praise
I could
God.
Swallow.
Yeah.
God knows, thank you. It's the small things that don't mean a lot to small things, but He will take care of you.
I was lost, I was blind. God is good.
Thank you, Jesus.
And all my life.
understand it.
Yeah. We'll go ahead and let the little guys go down. The goodness of God. Praise God. The Owens family sang about 2 or 3 weeks ago. Song called My Jesus, and our church service has near 600 views on Facebook and YouTube, and I'm not arrogant to believe that any of that has anything to do with the preaching, because I'm going to be honest, about 350 of them were me, and I never made it past them. Amen. But God has been doing a work in my heart and my life for, I don't believe that you ever should stop growing. If you stop growing, if I stop growing as a pastor, I need to quit pastoring. And I don't believe that we should ever stop growing as Christians. Because wouldn't it be rough to meet Jesus face to face one day and him tell you all of what you could be? You could have been this, but you decided you wanted to do other things. Man, it's rough. So I don't believe that we should quit growing. And he's been doing a work in my heart for the last 3 years that I can't explain and I can't put into words. He's torn me down of everything that I ever knew about religion, about the church, and about the Bible. And he's reconstructed in my life a relationship that is stronger than I've ever had it before. And I just decided that I think it's time to start telling people about my Jesus. So for the next foreseeable future, the sermon title will be, Let Me Tell You About My Jesus. And turn with me, if you will, to the book of John, chapter number 4. We find that Jesus is returning to Cana, where he worked his first miracle in John chapter 1. In John chapter 1, you find that he takes and he takes sewage water and turns it into wine and shows that he can make a mess a miracle. And I've been watching him do that for like months and months and months now, as the world says these people are nothing better than sewage water. And God says, I got this. Jesus says, I got this. And he makes it better than anything and anyone could imagine. So now Jesus has left Canaan and come and hung out with the Samaritan. He had a really successful ministry with the in Samaria there. And then he comes back in verse number 43. He's coming back to Canaan because there's a miracle waiting. And this is his second miracle. And I don't know if I've ever preached out of this section of Scripture. Matter of fact, most of what I'm going to be preaching over the next couple of months, I've either preached on very little or haven't preached on at all. Because I just want to tell you about him. If you don't mind standing for the reading of God's word in verse number 43. Now after 2 days, he departed thence and went to Galilee. For Jesus himself testified that a prophet hath no honor in his own country. And then he went to his own country. Isn't that funny? Have you ever read that? It's like he's not accepted in his own country, so he decides he's going to go to his own country. good. But there's more to that story. For Jesus himself testified that the prophet is has no honor in his own country. And then Jesus went to Galilee, and the Galileans received him. And having seen all the things that he did in Jerusalem at the feast, for they also went to the feast. And Jesus came again to Cana of Galilee, where, John wants to point out, where he made the water into wine. So that's special attention, right? And there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. And when he had heard that Jesus was come out of Galilee into, or out of Judea into Galilee, he went unto him and besought him that he would come down and heal his son, and he was at the point of death. And then Jesus said unto him, except ye see signs and wonders, ye will not believe. But look at verse 49. The nobleman said, sir, come down ere my son shall die. Jesus saith unto him, go thy way, thy son liveth. And the man believed the word. Did you see that? The man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. And as he was going down, his servant met him and told him, saying, thy son liveth. Then inquired he of them the hour when he began to be amend. And then they said unto him, yesterday, the seventh hour, the fever left him. So the father that knew that it was at the same hour in which Jesus said unto him, thy son liveth, and he himself believed, and his whole house. This, again, is the second miracle that Jesus did. Lord, we thank you for your word. And we thank you for your son. God, we only want to do one thing today. I just want to tell people about my Jesus. I pray that you'd empty me of self and sin, fill me with your spirit today. Oh, Lord God, it's the Super Bowl. And I pray that together, Jesus, we leave, no doubt. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. In verse number 50, we find Jesus says unto the man, go thy way, thy son liveth. And we want to point out that the man believed the word of Jesus. So he went his way. Did you see what happened? He believed the word. One of the hardest things for Christians to do, will you admit with me, is to believe the word. Amen. Because it's hard to see the word. It's easy to read the word. It's easy to understand the word, but it's not always easy to apply the word. The man believed and took Jesus at his word and began to move. He believed. The simplest form of believing is having faith that it exists. Simple. So now we find that the story highlights the belief of the man, but the belief of the man goes further. Because not only did he believe Jesus' word, but he also learned that Jesus can. You see, in verse 53, the story goes on and it tells us, so the father knew that it was at the same hour in which Jesus said unto them, thy son liveth, and himself believed, and his whole house. So in verse number 50, he believed the word. In verse number 53, he grew in his belief that Jesus can. Jesus told him, I can do it. Jesus proved to him, yes, I can. You see, growth takes place when you experience Jesus. Growth takes place. Jesus proved that his faith could become reality just by believing. It grew. And we see that progressive growth. I think that some people believe that in their Christian walk, that as soon as they bump their head on an altar and say the sinner's prayer, that they're automatically going to be full-grown Christians. That's just stupid. That doesn't make sense. When you go to preschool, they may let you put on a cap and gown, but that doesn't mean you're graduating high school. Right? When you go to kindergarten, they let you put on a cap and gown at the end of the year, and doesn't mean you're graduating high school. That means that you get to go on. Amen. And there's a lot of times that Christians think, I should be past this. I'm beyond this. I'm so smart. I'm so enlightened. I know everything there is to know about Jesus. And then the proverbial stuff hits the fan. And when that hits the fan, all of that enlightenment that you have goes with it. Am I right? But true growth comes in struggle, in pain, but in the triumph that Jesus can. Have you ever had somebody look at you and go, man, you're growing? You ever had that whenever you were growing up, they look at you and go, man, you're growing. The other day, Titus was walking, and somebody who hadn't seen him for a long time said, boy, you have grown, you know. But we don't see it as much because we're around him all the time. And so it's harder to understand, hey, he's grown. And I used to be obsessed with being tall. How many people's ever, Chris, he's still a little bit obsessed with it. I mean, when you were growing up, you always wanted to be taller than you were. I knew that I needed to be taller if I wanted to do what I wanted to do in life, and that was to play pro sports. So I seen this Brady Bunch episode. And I don't know if you've seen it, Bobby Brady, the baby. He's got tired of being the shortest one in the family, and he went out to the monkey bars, and he started stretching. And so I thought this is how I could grow a little bit. So I started doing stuff to try to grow, and. I'd go up to people, I'm like, I'm getting taller. And they was, and you know how you measure your height with someone? You start here and you work your way up here, right? I'm taller than you. And then somebody wants to measure you. Oh, we'll just measure you. And they put you up against the wall. And how many understands this, that if you lift the back of your heels, you grow. Yeah, right? Chris said he wanted to get on the teacups, but it was only this size, so he went like this. And he made the inch. Yeah. But you come in, and you rise up a little bit so that you're a little bit taller, because you remember where the line is, and you want to be taller than the line the last time, so you just lift your heels a little bit. You can fake it. And I remember Mom had washed a pair of my pants one time, and they were a little tight after she washed them. And they kind of went like this because they shrank. And so I thought I got taller. And you see, growth can be manipulated. And I watch Christians all the time that are faking their growth. They tell you and Facebook and Instagram and Twitter about how great they are and how strong their faith is. My faith has never been this strong. But then tests hit. You see, the reason why teachers give tests is it examines the knowledge that you gained. So you want to say, hey, I've grown. Well, there's a test coming your way. And we're going to find out just how much you've grown by the results of the test. Mm-hmm. This man had heard about Jesus. He had heard of what Jesus could do. Now he has an emergency in his own life and he's put to test. Will he find Jesus in the midst of his mess and find his miracle? Or will he fail because he'd rather see the show? Let me say this, you can write this down. You'll never grow if you're only seeking a show. What does an examination grow in us, preacher? I'm going to give you two things, and then I'm going to step aside and be a dad who gets to take his baby girl and put her under officially, not unofficially. We've been unofficially doing it for years, so she just giggles. Look at verse 48. What does an examination grow in us? It grows in us that Jesus is gracious in our true needs. Verse 48 says this, then said Jesus unto him, Except ye see signs and wonders, ye will not believe. The nobleman says, sir, come down ere my child die. And Jesus said unto him, go thy way, thy son lives. Did you notice what happened? Jesus said, except you see the fireworks, except if you see the show, you will not believe. But the man did not care about what the show brought. The man did not care about the fireworks and sparklers. The man did not care about pyrotechnics. The man only cared about the need because it was a real need in his life. And because he had a real need, Jesus showed that Jesus, my Jesus, is always gracious in a time of need. Have you ever examined your true needs? Did you hear that question? Not your desires, but your needs. I feel like I've been preaching about that a lot lately. It's like a hobby horse. You get on it, it's fun. Amen. You might not be going anywhere, but it's fun to rock back and forth on. You see, we have a lot of people who live for their desires, but they don't ever pay attention to their needs because they confuse their needs or their desires with their needs. So have you ever examined your true needs? What you really need? Not what you want, what you really, really want, but what you need. You see, a true need strips you of who you are and focuses you on who he is. Notice in verse number 46, the Bible calls this man a nobleman, doesn't it? Do you see that? The word is basilikos. Basilikos. There we go. I got that. Write that down. Tell Daniel about it. I said it once, one time. Good. Amen. Basilikos. And it means this. Of or belonging to a king. So when they saw this man, whenever they would notice that this man was in town, they knew that a representative of the king, Herod, was now in the land. And he was there to perform a duty. He was not there because he wanted to be there. He was not there because he liked to be there. He was there because the king told him that was where he had to be. You see, it was not a mistake that he was in the town. He was going to be doing some collecting. Otherwise, he would have been at home with his son. Oh. You see, and then he would be identified with the king by his dress, by his attitude, by his walk, and by all of those people that would surround him and protect him. He was a part of a different king. But then the Bible says, and when he had heard about the king, Jesus, was come out of Galilee, or out of Judea into Galilee, he went unto him and besought him that he would come down and heal his son. You say, preacher, can you tell me what's going on here? This man of high class who was out there collecting for the foreign government that was occupying the land lowered himself from who he was and sought out Jesus. You see, when you truly have a need, you're willing to put yourself to the side to seek Jesus. You don't think about your title. You don't think about your bank account. You don't think about all of the stuff that you have in your life. You just think about, this is what I need, and you take the need to Jesus. A true need also pulls you away from your own personal agenda. Oh, I've been liking that one too, haven't I? Your own personal agenda, and points you to submission. Verse 48 says this: Then said Jesus unto him, Except you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. You see, I want you to think about this. The last time Jesus was in town, his mama said, Boy, I need you to make this water into wine. He said, I'm not going to do it. And then she said, Please do it. And he did it. So he did this major miracle in an area of the town where people would see it. And then it spread from there to other people. And by the time that he came back to this town, his hype train, if you will, come in with him. So everybody began to look. They said, There's Jesus. And you know, Jesus was a Galilean, wasn't he? So it went from, This is Jesus, the carpenter's son, to this is Jesus, our Jesus, our hometown hero, who's come home to show us more heroic things. So they were all gathered around him, hoping to see that there was a miracle. And so Jesus looked around and said, All anybody wants here from me is not to believe in me, not to grow up and fall on their knees in front of me and anoint me as king. All you want to see is signs and wonders. All you're here for is the show. And may I stop for a minute? There's a lot of people who come to this church and they want to hear the good choir singing and they want to hear some great songs and they want to be a part of the show. They want to see the preacher stand on top of the pews. They want to get the spit on their face. I don't know why. They want sweat all over them, honey. But they are here for the show. But may I say to you this morning, the show is not what's needed in our lives. It is the Lord Jesus, my Jesus, the one who can show grace in the time of pain, the one who can see past our problems and our perspectives and see that we have a need in our lives and can supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. Verse 49 shows the undaunted man at the statement. He did not defend himself, did he? You see, I've noticed this. This is free. That when you tell somebody the truth, if it hits them, they justify. I mean, like Justin Timberlake, they justified. Amen? Some of you got that. The rest of you too young or too old. I'm sorry. You got me, Daniel? Yeah. Had a whole tour about it. Amen? Help me, Lord Jesus. But we justify because somebody hits us, embraces us with the truth about ourselves. We could either change or we can say, no, I've got this because of this and because of this and because of this. No, true change comes when you accept your reality and you change from that reality. It's called growth. Well, I don't even know what I was talking about, but that's what they call it. rabbit trail in it. I caught it. Oh, here we are. Here he says this. Jesus says, except for you see signs and wonders, he said, sir, come down ere my child dies. He said, I'm not coming to see a show. I'm coming because my son's laying on his deathbed. I have no purpose but this. And whether you choose to come with me or you choose to stay, I'm still going to have this need in my life. You see, whenever you have a true need, you're willing to pull off from your agenda and focus in on submitting yourself. He had a need. And he knew that it was out of his power. So in the middle of his need, Jesus showed him grace. You say, preacher, what's grace? It's favor. But it's not favor that you earn. It's favor that is imparted upon you without ever being earned. You did nothing to deserve this. I want to say this. I've experienced a lot in my life. A lot of pain, a lot of tragedy. But I stand here as a man in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. I deserve nothing that I have in my life. I don't deserve my wife. I don't deserve my children. I don't deserve the house that I live in. I don't deserve the job that I have. I don't deserve the money in the bank. I don't deserve the shoes on my feet. I don't deserve anything. It's only because of the grace of God that I stand here before you. I'm not an alcoholic. I'm not a drug addict. I'm not hooked up on anything. I am standing here today in the grace of God, changed, different. I'm no longer who I used to be. I'm no longer what I used to be. I'm a blessed man because of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, God, Jesus can look past all of the stuff in our lives, all of the desires, and he can see that we have a need, and he can show grace in it. Let's read the Bible. Let's go on. See, do you have a need today that only the grace of Jesus can fix? What does examinations grow in us? Number two, it grows in us that Jesus is powerful in our time of need. It does not say how he uses his power all the time, but he's powerful. Look at this. He said, Jesus said to him, go thy way, thy son liveth. And the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. I don't know if you understand this, but I need to say it to you. The son was healed at go. What happened? He put his son in Jesus' hands. And when the son got in Jesus' hands, that means Jesus controlled life in him, or to be absent from the body and be healed with the Lord. It was now in Jesus' hands. So it was when he said, go, he said, I got this. You go. Stop worrying about it. Because I got this. It may not be the way that you want it to happen, but I got this. It may not be the way that you're praying about it, but I got this. It may not be from the perspective that you want it to come, but I got this. And you know, I need you to notice this, that distance could not stop him. You see, his power was so, he is so powerful that distance could not overcome him. You see, the man was here and the boy was 15 miles away in Capernaum. But it could have been 15,000 miles. And as soon as Jesus spoke, change can happen. I'm thankful to say to this, that when Jesus speaks into a situation, it may not be how I want it. It may not be how you want it. But it's always how he wants it. And change will happen. There's no distance that can stop him. And there's no obstacles that can slow him. the power of his healing, the Bible says this, was immediate. You say, how do you know it's immediate? Well, the Bible literally tells us all about it. In verse number 52, the boy recovered in the seventh hour. He asked him. In verse number 53, the father knew that the hour that Jesus said unto him, your son will live, at that same very moment it was done. There's no time constraints on him. There's no obstacles that slow him down. Nothing. You see, my Jesus knows what we need when we need it. And he's not afraid to flex his power when we need it. No distance. The Bible says this, that all power is given to him. All of it. All of it. After he died, was buried, and resurrected, he said this. All power is given to me. All of it. But sometimes we don't see his power because we get used to it. Did you hear that? I'm almost done. You can go sleep in a minute, all right? Sometimes we don't see the power of Jesus in our lives because we got used to it. A couple of years ago, we had this. I guess it would have been when Titus was about two or three. We had one of those mushroom pools. I don't know if y'all call them mushroom pools, but you blow up the top ring, and then it mushrooms, like you put water in it. But ours was a little more stretchier than others. Instead of going up, it went out. You could swim around in a circle and never see the sunlight. It was like being in a tunnel. It was awesome until the wind blew. But my dad used to work for elevator companies, and they would, Chris, you know this, when y'all would rip a cord in half, Dad would take it home, and he would repair it the Campbell's Creek way with some tape. So I went and borrowed one of his extension cords, and I pulled it up the fence line, and I let it hang there, and I plugged it into the filter, and it ran. And for about a couple of months, it ran really good. And I'd cut grass, and I'd move the cord, and I'd cut under it, and I'd set it back down, and I'd come back and I'd cut the grass and I'd move the cord. Teens, I'm glad you did. This didn't happen to you. But I moved, one day I got to taking for granted that the cord was just a cord. And I grabbed onto it without respecting the cord. You know what I mean? I didn't pay attention to where the tape was. Amen. And the sun that beats down up Campbell's Creek during the whole summer had smelted that thing, and it had cracked it. So when I stuck my hand down on there, I learned that there was power that was inside of that cord. But because I had constantly cut around this thing, and I grabbed onto it, and I'd even seen that it had power because the pool was still working. It wasn't green. There wasn't nothing wrong with it. It was still doing what it was supposed to do. So I should have realized that, hey, this thing's live and in color. Amen. So, but when I grabbed onto it, I found out, honey, that it had some power inside of it. But I got used to it being there. And I wonder, have you got used to what Jesus is running in your life? I mean, you plugged into him years ago, and he's running everything in your life in the background. He's holding it all together. What kind of jolt does it take for you to recognize that all things are held together because of him? You, honey, let me just tell you the truth. Nobody's told you since last Sunday. Let me be straight with you. You're a train wreck. You got problems. You got, let me tell you, this world don't like you. It doesn't want to see you succeed. It doesn't want to make, listen, it doesn't want to have any success stories out of your life. It wants to put you on the news and make a train wreck and a mockery of your life. It wants to drag you down and beat you down. But may I say to you, everything you got's been held together by the grace of God and by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you, my friend, can see great growth in your life because of the power of Jesus. So when you get in your little hut of whininess, how many's got a hut of whininess? Amen. When you go there, I know you're going to go there, all right? And you start complaining about all the things that you don't have. How Jesus just don't love you enough because your house doesn't have a third story to it. Why not be thankful for the two stories and the air conditioner that pumps in the second one? Amen. Because some of us would like to have an air conditioning that pumps in the second one. Amen. I don't even know what that floor looks like, I'm going to be honest. Sydney went up there and I said, "What are you doing up there?" She said, "I'm cleaning. You want to come up?" "Nope. I'd help you clean if it was down here. But I ain't walking into hell for it." Amen. It's hot up there. Listen, it's 68 degrees in here. I'm sweating. There's something ain't right about my body. Probably what I put into it. That's free. What was I talking about, Jim? Save me. I was talking about how hot it was. How we need better air conditioning. Jesus, have you met him? Because his grace can get you through it. And when you can't, his power can. You say, "How do you know?" Because I've grabbed onto the live wires a few times, and he's gave me a jolt that makes me recognize that he holds all things in the palm of his hands. And it's not my desire that keeps me walking. It's his desires. And the reason why I have breath in my body today is because he allowed it. And the reason that I have a voice in my mouth today is because he gave it to me. All good things come from the Father up above. All. I don't know who you are this morning, but I do know this, that no sermon has ever been preached here by mistake. There's somebody here this morning that doesn't know about my Jesus. You've never experienced his grace, and you've never recognized his power. And you just looked at your life and you said, "Man, I need this." Why not today? There's other people in here that's experienced the grace of God, whose the power of Jesus has manifested itself in your life, but you're taking it for granted. And you sit here like a good Baptist that you are. And maybe today you just need to come say thank you. With every head bowed and every eye closed, let me ask you this. Have you taken an examination of your life? Have you seen that he's graceful in your time of need? Have you understood that everything he does is by his power in your life? And everything you've got, he's holding it together. If you're here today and you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I want to say this. How are you making it? Maybe you're here today and you say this, "I want to lift my hand and give testimony to the fact that if Jesus comes or I should die, I'm ready to meet him. I know I've been saved. Here's my hand." Amen. Maybe you're here today and you say this, "Preacher, I don't know if I've ever been saved. I've said a few words, but I sure would like to know that my name's written down in the Lamb's Book of Life, that I've gave my heart to Jesus. Here's my hand. Here's my hand." Just maybe some Christians in the room will say this, "I want to raise my hand and say and ask your preacher to pray for me that I'd always remember that I live off the grace of God. Amen. Preacher, will you pray for me that I'd recognize his power in all the little things in my life? Here's my hand. I wonder how many people will do this morning. So many, countless people raise their hand. I wonder how many people will step out of their seat and come down here and thank God for his grace. Thank you. Thank God for his power to change your life. These have come. How about you? I just want to say thank you for being so good to me. People all over the room moving. Won't you come? If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, why not today? Why not today? Thank you, God, for all that you gave us. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for showing favor that we did not earn, your grace in our lives. Everything we have came from you. We don't deserve none of it, but we sure are thankful for it. God, Jesus, thank you for holding everything together. The word go, because sometimes it feels like we're coming apart, but we're thankful that your power is there to keep us together. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, I do want to do this. I want to invite you to stick around for the baptism service. We only got one today that I'm aware of. We have two others. One had to cancel on us. We got to get him a new alarm clock, apparently. That's what he said. So it didn't go off. Amen. We're living in a day and time where most of us have our alarm clock on our phones. Like, we can do this. I know you ain't leaving your phone without getting it charged, because most of it, y'all sleeping with it in your hand. Y'all's obsessed with it. Y'all got problems. Amen. I can't even joke with you people today. Where's Gracie at? Get her back up here. Y'all were happy a while ago. What was I talking about, Chris? Oh, we're going to have a baptism here in a second. I get to baptize my little girl. I hope you stick around for it. If you'd like to be baptized, just see Pastor Chris and me or one of our deacons or trustees, and we'll do it. Next Sunday morning at 9:30, you're going to be here. Those of you who's been here for a while now and hasn't bought the cow, it's your turn. So we want you here, and let us know that you're going to be here so we can get you something to eat and enjoy it. Miss Nancy will be there with a bright smile to greet you, and hot coffee. Amen. If you don't like coffee, we've got water in jugs down there. Weirdos. Chris.
If you'd like for your child to come up and be a part and watch the baptism, we'd like for you to go down now and get those children. We don't like to turn them loose. We want to make sure that your hand touches their hand. So if you want to go get your child, you're excused to do such. And we're going to, Brother Steve's going to pick out some fantastic music back there. while we're getting ready for the baptism. But if you need to leave, God bless you until we see you again. Father, thank you for what we've experienced today. Bless all of these that are here. And we pray that until such a time as we're able to be together again, that your grace and mercy would continue to flow. For it's in Christ's precious name we pray, and all God's children said, amen.